The curriculum is called Genes to Society because we recognize that the individual variability had really two large sources. One was the genetic makeup of each person, and the second was the accumulated environmental experiences of each person. So to do one without the other made no sense at all. And we're very fortunate at Johns Hopkins to have a superb school of public health as well as a superb medical school. So we are well equipped to present and teach and educate in both sort of basic biology of medicine as well as more social issues that span populations rather than individual patients. So we try to pull all of that together, decrease the lecture time, increase the sort of computerized learning tools that are now available, increase simulations, emphasizing patient safety and cross-cutting themes like professionalism across the 4 years. And we also built in some novel things that sort of a chronic concern about medical education is that in the old style where you sort of had 2 years of basic science exposure, first year was normal basic science, the second was abnormal, was pathology basically, and then 2 clinical years. And many students during their basic science years would say, well, you know, I'm really interested in laying on the hands, why do I need to understand the Krebs cycle? And so it was only until after they got on the wards and had the experience of managing a patient, let's say in diabetic ketoacidosis, where the Krebs cycle is not working in many different ways, they would say, oh, gee, I wish I had paid attention to first year when I was studying the Krebs cycle. So we get them in touch with their patients as quickly as possible in the first year. And then we built in these intersessions between blocks of time in all 4 years. In the first 2 years, the intersessions focus on clinical topics, giving them another window on clinical activities in the first 2 years. And the second 2 years, the intersessions focus on basic science. Being a leader in medicine requires one to be a leader in biomedical research, and we certainly feel like we are among the leaders in biomedical research. And I think we all think that this is something that separates Johns Hopkins from many other places that one could get a medical education. And so we think it's enormously important, not only in terms of informing the students, but also giving them a certain rigor in the way they think about problems and in the way they evaluate the literature and scientific trends and all sorts of things. So the scientific education that they receive is enormously important, and we didn't want to sacrifice on that. On the other hand, we did want to spread it out so that they were more receptive to it, and they heard it at different stages, so perhaps more likely to carry it forward with them over the subsequent decades of their career. Changing a medical curriculum is really a big deal. It's like turning a gigantic oil tanker. It really is hard. There's so many people involved. We have to realize at Hopkins is that we're fortunate enough to attract a very top-notch medical student. So they're excellent when they walk in the door. So it's not good enough to say that when they leave they're excellent, because they were excellent when they came in. We have to show that what we've given them is something that will allow them to take advantage of their talents, their enormous talents, and improve medicine over the next 4 generations. I think I speak for the school to say that we're in for the duration. We have a long tradition of excellence and we want to maintain it.